This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank Bob for being here and sharing with us his model. We are making this this series of webinars with the aim of increasing, say, the awareness on system dynamics. And COVID-19 is now really a world issue, and this your model, I think it's very interesting, and it's a natural follow-up of a webinar we did the last week. So with not much to add, I would prefer just pass the words to you, Bob. Thank you again for being in here with us, and it's with you. Thanks.
Great. Thanks, Rudolf. So I'm going to basically kind of tell a little bit of story around my thinking about the model development for COVID-19. And I want to start in a place we're all pretty familiar with, which is a standard SIR model done up exactly the way we typically do them, with regular stocks and things flowing through that. And if we run a model like this, so I will be using Stella 2.0 in this presentation. So we've got all the loop analysis going on, and what we can see is that early on in the process, this is not surprising, we have a positive feedback loop right here. You can see that actually here. That is a positive feedback loop early in the process. And then as the simulation progresses, that becomes less dominant. And the negative feedback loop here, which is running out of people, becomes more dominant, and that's this balancing loop here. And then eventually we get into a nice steady state in which the drain from the infected people into the immune people is dominant. That balancing loop is dominant, and that's the rest of it. And here I've actually plotted R naught, which is 1.26 for the way things are set up right now, and R, which is the thing that goes from R naught down to a lower number as the susceptible population decreases and the fraction susceptible also decreases. So this is a great little model. The disease duration in this model is 4 days, and so it's typically representative of the flu. And when we think about a condition like COVID-19, the disease duration there is substantially longer. So we all kind of know what happens when you increase the disease duration. You get a sharper peak that happens sooner. But COVID-19 is like a lot longer. It's more than a week. It's up there. And so we see this very sharp peak. And I said to myself as I was thinking about this, well, there's people should be in this infected pool for that period of time, then probably using this perfect mixing idea that basically things they start draining out as soon as they arrive here is not going to give us a very accurate picture of what's happening. So back at 4 days, I'm not too worried about that. But when I get up to 7 to 12 days, which is probably more realistic for COVID-19, I'm worried that what we're doing is we're putting people into the infected group and we're immediately taking them out, because this is a negative exponential distribution. And as a consequence, they're not in there long enough to have the kind of effect that we might see that they would have on the disease. So that's where my thinking all started on this. I went from a kind of standard SIR model for a flu or other typical communicable disease that has a fairly low, fairly short duration. And as a consequence, the fact that people are actually only in here for, you know, a DT instead of a few days probably doesn't make that much difference to one with a very long duration. And so I set up a different way, and I'm going to kind of jump to a combined model. This is actually one I showed during the webinar I did on this, but it allows us to look in combination at three different ways of thinking about this, because I was trying to decide what's the best way to do it. So perfect mixing is what we've got. This is a little bit, this is exactly SIR, exactly the same thing as what we were just looking at. And then I said, what happens if you're not mixing? And not mixing can be done with conveyors, where people come in, they become infected. there's an infecting, they become infected, same structure, but rather than using a stock to stock relationship, we're using a stock into a conveyor and then into a stock. And that is going to have different behavior than we would see with the model. And I said, and what's kind of the gold standard here? And the gold standard is probably to represent individuals as individuals. So this is the same structure, but now instead of having each stock be a collection of people, each stock is simply a person. It's either one or a zero. You're a susceptible individual. There's some probability of becoming infected. After you become infected, there's a distribution of time, which is this recovering time, which uses a Weibull distribution of what's happening, and then you become a recovered person and you flow in. And I consider this, for this type of thing, and using this very simple representation, the gold standard against which we want to compare the way our model behaves relative to what's happening here. So feel free to jump in with questions at any time during the presentation, and if I'm not being clear. The interesting thing about this model, from my perspective, is you can get it to behave roughly the same doing with all of these three different representations, but if you have an intervention, so the pickup time, which is 0 to 30 in this case, is pretty much the same for these. In order to make it the same, I actually had to adjust the contact rate. So for the screet and my non-mixed model, the contact rate is 40 persons, touch per person per day. I like my units of measure to be kind of full-blown. But we have to go up to almost 50 to get the same kind of takeoff behavior in the model that is just using the stocks. And I thought that was pretty interesting, but obviously we can still get there. But what happens if we then change the contact rate? So if the contact adjustment goes to, I can't remember how this is used, to zero. No, I want it to go to one. If the contact adjustment is one, this model is a little slow to represent, to simulate, because there are 1,000 people in the discrete case. Just run it again. So if we have no, if the contact gate going to one, is say there's no adjustment to contact, and in that case we get a pretty close relationship between these three different models. We can see that the infected, all the same name, that's my fault, but the perfect mixing one is shown in blue. The discrete one is shown in the light green. Just make this a little not mixing. Okay, I don't know why the labels are coming out without that. Somewhere I check something. The blue is the perfect mixing one. The discrete one is the light pink one, and then the one in which I have used conveyors rather than mixing is shown in red. And we can see that the blue and the pink are pretty similar. Mixing, perfect mixing. Are pretty similar, and they come down a little bit different here, but when we go back to a contact adjustment to 0.5, i.e. we do something to intervene in this and stop the spread of the epidemic, we see that there's quite a bit of difference. And there are two really interesting things to note here. The first is that the change, it's in model settings. Yes. Where is it in model settings though? Page settings. Hide module prefix and objects. I don't know how I ever checked that. The change in the not mixing case, you can see the bump is smooth, whereas in the perfect mixing case, we see almost an elbow in terms of the number of people becoming infected over time. So that's a pretty substantial difference. And the gold standard, so actually I'm making the opposite case. Yeah, I'm mixing my things up. Sorry, the not mixing case, yeah, I'm confused. I hope I haven't confused you too much. The not mixing case is the one where I use conveyors. And we can see in the not mixing case, when you change the contact, what happens is a relatively small, it's noticeable. You can see it right there, but it's a relatively small bump in the way the number of infectings is going up. Whereas in the perfect mixing one, you get this almost sharp sawtooth going down towards nothing. And then it smooths out and lasts for a much longer period of time, whereas you get a much steeper curve when you're not mixing them. And that's much more representative of the agent-based representation, which, as I say, I kind of treat as the gold standard, in which you get a relatively rapid decline, but you don't get anything noticeable happening right at the point in which you make an intervention. And this goes to the something that I'm quite concerned about, is there's a pretty substantial delay on the other side, and we'll go to that in another model, in which you lift the intervention and you don't see any response for quite a while, whereas a perfect mixing model suggests you would see a response. And so my concern became, well, if we're using these perfect mixing models, they're not going to be able to be very good at letting us understand what is happening as policy changes are put in place, so that we're changing the rate of infection or the number of people who are becoming, we're trying to basically change the contact rate with social distancing and whatnot. And we're not seeing the effect of that nearly as quickly as we would expect to. People are impatient, they don't see an effect. They say, oh, this doesn't matter, we don't need to do it. And that attitude is actually not, is somewhat prevalent here. I'm puzzled by what's happening in Brazil. It's tragic beyond beyond measure, and I don't really understand the variety of attitudes that people have there. But it's easy to see why you do something, nothing seems to happen. You come to the conclusion that whatever it was that you did didn't matter, and it's because we're using the wrong models. Now, this is a kind of a funny situation, because obviously most people aren't even to the level of this kind of thinking about the way a disease propagates. But a lot of the epidemiological people are using differential equation models, which are exactly this, perfect mixing models. And as a consequence, they inform the discussion using that kind of mindset. Well, if you make a change, you'd expect to see a response, when in fact the response doesn't happen for a while. And it's people are beginning to understand that it's fairly delayed. And the trouble is, with something like COVID-19, it's delayed for a very long period of time and you don't see a response at all. So that's kind of the conceptual frame about why I did the model the way I did it. And now I want to jump to kind of the model as I did it that has a little bit more of the detail around what's happening. Which is this one. So this is a model, it's set up, the data are somewhat old at this point because I haven't had a chance to get back to this. But rather than using the simple SIR model, I said, well, what's really happening is they have a number of stages. At first, they're not contagious. Then they become asymptomatic but contagious for a period of time. Then they become symptomatic and contagious for a period of time, not symptomatic, symptomatic but not no longer contagious, and then finally they go into the recovered pool, which is the same for everybody. And of course, one of the important things that we're talking about in any public policy discussion is testing. How do we bring people out from these pools where they've been infected to understand how they might show up in these pools where they're tested, so we understand what they've got and we might be able to do something differently. This model also does a variation on contacts, where if you're in different groups, you're going to end up contact with a lower contact rate. So if you're asymptomatic, then you're just like a normal person. But if you're symptomatic, you might change your behavior. And the amount you change your behavior depends upon, actually these are tested. The amount you change your behavior depends upon the degree of symptomaticity. So there's a mild symptomatic adjustment. If you're mildly symptomatic, you see people a little bit less. There's a moderate and severe adjustment to how much you would come in contact. So, and this is a natural thing that happens when people get sick. They tend to get in contact a little bit less, and that's actually something that helps slow the spread of disease naturally. And fundamentally what that means is that the R naught, or the reproductive factor for any pathogen is likely not really what it would be if people were completely asymptomatic, because as soon as people show symptoms, they do change behavior, and as a consequence, the contact that they realize with other people goes down. And so one of the challenges of COVID-19 is there is a fairly large asymptomatic population. Now, this, as they say, is based on data from a while ago, but this is looking at the state of New York and trying to understand what is happening with that population using testing. Well, the testing data is pretty limited. So there is some testing data from the state of New York, but it's not of great quality. So fundamentally relying on the number of people dying as reported and the number of presumed new infections, which includes both tested infections and presumed infections. And this is a model of kind of what's happening. The blue line is the data as reported mostly through the Johns Hopkins and then collated through the New York Times data collation activity. And the red line is the simulation model as it's doing things. And so this is with data up until this point in time. And if I'd had time, I would have refreshed the data so we could see how it compares a little later. But the thing I was most interested in understanding is if you have a setup like this, where there has been pretty substantial social distancing restrictions placed on the population, what happens when you then go in and remove that social distancing? And so I've got two parameters here. One is the time of which social distancing is lifted, and that's in days, and I actually might bring that up to more like 3 months because it seems to be happening fairly slowly. And then the other one is when do you do it? And right now I do it after the end of the simulation, so obviously nothing happens. But the interesting thing in this case is if you lift it earlier, even if you lift it fairly slowly, the second peak, so to speak, dwarfs completely the first peak. And that's something that worries me, obviously, and watching very carefully kind of see what happens in the United States. New York is opening very, very slowly, but Georgia and other elements of the United States have been opening pretty quickly. In Brazil, you've got counteracting pressures, but you've got a lot more communities in your country that do not have the chance to even exercise a lot of this social distancing. And so you haven't seen the kind of control that we've seen in the United States, especially in New York, which was the epicenter of the initial set of infections, that has been realized in with respect to these controls. And so that is kind of the genesis of my thinking in constructing this model, and then the way in which I brought it together. And you can see that this particular model is interesting in that this is actually one of the most fascinating things. I'm going to just put this back to 365. The fraction of the population with antibodies comes out at about 13% or so, which says that about 13% of the population has been exposed to the virus and still assumed in this model that they've developed immunity, and that the rest of the population has not. And that number is consistent with the randomized tests that have been done in New York. But the interesting thing about it is a lot of people have been exposed, 13% of the population. In order to get the kind of reproductive factor, the R factor, down below one so that you've got a disease that is not epidemic prone, the fraction of the population with antibodies needs to be closer to 70%. And you can maybe see that if I bring this, maybe if I'm lucky. I was just asked about masking policy and the nature of the contact thing. So I haven't looked at in depth at what it is, what elements of behavior are the ones that are really affecting the contact as it pertains to the transmission of the disease. And to be honest, there are two kind of very fundamental questions from my perspective that haven't been answered about this disease and that need to be answered to to figure out what really should be done to it with the least amount of kind of damage to both the health of the population and the overall economy. And that is the first one. What is it that causes us to be able to pass the disease or not pass the disease? Is mandatory wearing of masks an effective measure without the other social distancing measures? Or is it, do we require a whole bunch of different social distancing measures in order to reduce the contacts which can lead to infections? And then the other big unknown from my perspective is, what is the real profile of infectivity? Because the evidence suggests that later stages of the disease, anytime it manifests as seriously, you're already no longer infected. The virus tends to migrate the active portions of it to inner respiratory tracts, never really making it out of the lungs. And as a consequence, even when someone is extremely sick, they may not be at all dangerous to other people in the sense that they could give them the disease. So or that may not be true at all. It's just the testing that is hard to do that way. And that is what I was trying to do. And then the other thing that I've really been struggling with in this model is, how do you represent what's happening with testing? And how do you do, in practice, what do you do about testing? So the way I've done here is I've done a contact tracing testing, where there's a recent positive test, then some number of contacts are traced given on that positive test, and that those contacts are then traced. Not all of them will have the disease, obviously, and even some of them do have the disease, they may test negative depending on the stage they're at and the quality of the disease. PCR testing is close to a 30% false negative rate. It's not very accurate. Sensitive is the I think the word that is used. But that does lead to asymptotic testing, and it gives you an effective rate. So how many people who are asymptomatic but sick will be tested and become positive? They immediately get put into this tested not contagious. Behavior can change, and you can actually contain the disease. So for diseases like MERS and SARS, this contact tracing ended up being a fairly easy thing to do because people were relatively symptomatic very early in the process. You could lock them down, make sure that they were isolated, and as a consequence, the number of people who were in a position to cause anyone harm would decrease, and those diseases were essentially contained in that way. So the infected not contagious doesn't matter for the spread, but if you can capture people in these early stages, then it's much less likely that someone downstream will be able to pick up the disease from them. So that's my train of thought a little bit on where I was going with the social distancing. So that's the other point of the testing, is representing testing is actually a little bit tricky. And let me kind of show you how I did that. I'm not completely satisfied with it yet. So there's symptomatic testing, which is fairly straightforward. I'm not sure. So we've got this target of how much we want to test. And the target symptomatic testing is basically how many people are symptomatic but haven't tested positive. And then unfortunately, we're going to test a bunch of people with a similar clinical presentation. And then so this is everybody. It's kind of in the pool of we might want to test them based upon how they're presenting. And then there's a target test rate for those symptomatic people. And if the target test rate for those symptomatic people is high, we use up a lot of our testing capacity. And we're testing people who are symptomatic, who've already changed their behavior regardless of their understanding of COVID because they are sick, less likely to be contacting people, and less of that testing capacity is going into here. So the cool thing about this model and I didn't practice this recently, so let's see if I still get it right. So let's put it back to a point where we have a resurgent disease. And then let's go in and muck with the testing stuff, which I didn't put exactly where that was. It's a little bit harder to see. So suppose that we want to have more testing. So I've said we get as much testing as we want. This testing adequacy is one. Let's test more, a larger number of people who get in touch with other people and see what kind of effect that has. And we can see we're lowering that. And there is actually a threshold here, which to spare us the thing, I'll just make a ghost of this and bring it over to here. And then go back to still alive. And if we bring this up to a sufficiently high number, yeah, this doesn't make sense. It doesn't quite make sense. If we bring it up to sufficiently high people, I was thinking that we would finish that. Actual testing is going up. So
we lost you.
Yeah, I know. Sorry, having a little trouble here. All right. Screen gone too. Let me see if I can get it back. All right. Back here. I'm not sure why that's not doing what I expected it to do. Okay. All right. Let me just restore this to noon. Let me try that again. It should have worked. And it didn't. Okay. So we lift some social distancing and then we go and test more people. And it doesn't have any effect. What is the total amount of people? So as I say, the way I've implemented testing, I'm not completely happy with. Asymptomatic testing is still zero. Recently tested positive. Okay, so nobody's testing positive. Oh, so symptomatic target test rate for mild people is 2, so we need to bring that up some. For moderate people is 5%, we need to bring that up some. And then for severe people, it's 20%, which is a pretty good number anyway. And if we do that, then we start seeing this coming down, and you can see the responsiveness then of the contacts. So kind of hard to see it because I have too many runs here. Let me get rid of a few of them. But we're actually getting nothing there. And then as I dial this back, you can see all of a sudden you get to this explosion. So there's a threshold of contact tracing that will completely dampen out the disease. So the kind of nature of the behavior is correct there. But as I say, I'm not satisfied with the way I've been able to do contact tracing. It's actually a fairly difficult thing. Contact tracing is, by its very nature, the following of an individual from one spot to another spot. And as a consequence, when we're doing it in an aggregate model, we have to make some adjustments, and it's a little bit, has been difficult. So that's kind of where it stands, where the work I'm doing stands, its genesis, and kind of where I've gotten to. I'm happy to answer questions or entertain thoughts and different ways of doing things.
I have a very, I would say, obvious and could even seem a little dumb, but I'm making always the same question at the beginning, as the aim of this webinar is about system dynamics. The very first question is, why system dynamics? Why not using the other modeling we have been seeing, Markov chains and this kind of thing? Why system dynamics?
So there's kind of, Markov chains are in use. There are some sort of more agent-based stuff. So you see the speed and responsiveness on the agent-based stuff. And the other thing that is true actually for a lot of the models, even some of the ones that are using differential equations, is they're depending upon random number generators in order to get a population distribution of outcomes, which makes it a lot harder to interpret the results. System dynamics has the big advantage of allowing you to do things with a deterministic set of things, which means that you can see how the structure of the system is impacting the numbers as opposed to the random variation is impacting the numbers. So it makes it much easier to think about the structural relationships and to think about the policies as they might play out. And it also makes, like you see with Still Alive, it much easier to kind of move things around and see how the model would respond and come up with stories about why that's happening.
Right. Anybody has another question?
I have one. I was curious why you used the Weibull distribution for the agents.
So the Weibull distribution is extremely flexible, and what I ended up doing is I wanted something that was kind of bell-shaped, but not certainly not normal, because you don't have infinite tails and something like this. So it's actually a truncated Weibull with slightly wider edges than you'd get in a normal distribution, but a definite peak sort of in the middle. It's a unimodal distribution. So the Weibull just has a flexibility to get me that without adjusting parameters to the way I wanted them.
Question from Hamilton, if I'm not wrong. Maybe you can make it, Hamilton.
So the question is, are there other leverage points your model has revealed?
So testing and the contact rate are really all that's shown. Neither of these are surprises. I think the question is the kind of the nature of the structuring for the testing and then what it is about behavior that's changing the contact rate. And this model is not going to be able to answer that. That's going to be more field studies to answer that question. The contact tracing one, I think we could make headway, but this is a place where indeed using a different methodology for contact tracing, like with the agent-based model, might be more productive because it's far simpler to represent that type of activity if you're using agents than it is if you're using a kind of aggregated model.
Would that also be true? You talked about the behavioral modification that people have. Would that be true for that part as well? Or
well, you need information about what is happening in different places to understand why it is. So we actually do have although the data are not generally very good, we do have a wide variety of experiments that are in play right now in different places doing things in different ways. And I think it is possible to derive from those at the sort of population level, the outcomes that we're seeing in the different places. And so to the extent that we can quantify the differences between those places, we do have the ability to say a little bit about the types of behavior changes that really make a difference. It's a fair bit of work because you have to really be looking at things at geographically specific levels and making a comparison of them, but it is important stuff to understand. So it's probably worth it. Unfortunately, I do not have the time to do it.
What about the personal behavioral modification you talked about earlier? When someone starts to feel symptoms, they may decrease their contact rate.
So that's an assumption going into the model. It's not one that we really validated trying to use any studies or whatnot. It's just a kind of common sense assumption that went in there. In terms of changing that, so if you feel a little bit sick, then start to do it more, that might be interesting. I will say that in this New York model, when I calibrated it, came up with about 60% asymptomatic, which is a really, really high number, which means 60% of the people who are carriers of the disease do not actually know they are carriers. There wouldn't be any behavioral modification to them, even if you had implemented that kind of a thing where if you're the least bit sick, you stay away from people.
Just have one question, Bob. I don't know. I didn't perceive or I didn't so about age profiling.
So there is no age profile in this model. So I was really just looking at epidemiological risk and the way that it would propagate through the system. The age profile has a big impact on severity of disease. I just categorize people into severe, moderate, and mild. The age profile and pre-existing conditions will have a big impact on the severity of disease. And if you get to something like loads on healthcare systems, you that would be very, very helpful because it gives you a better indication of kind of where the load would be coming from. But in terms of pure pure spread of the disease, it's not actually telling us very much. And that was the focus in this work.
What are the severity categories that you have, Bob?
I have severe, which means hospitalization is required, moderate, which means that you're not able to do much, and mild, which means that you're noticeably sick, but it's not really interfering with your ability to get things done, and then asymptomatic, which means you don't even know that you have the disease.
And do you know what percentage of the people who had symptoms were mild after you calibrated to New York?
So for New York, mild. It's up here. So fraction asymptomatic, I didn't say 60, it was almost 50%, not 60%, I remembered wrong. The fraction of those who were symptomatic but were mild, it was 68%. So that's of the leftover 55%, 68% of them, you have to multiply them together, roughly 35% of people were mild, and then 38% of the moderate and severe were moderate, and 65% were severe. So I don't have a lot of confidence in these numbers, but they are kind of interesting.
Wait, so the moderate were a fraction of how many?
So you start out with 100%, you take away 55% because you got 45% asymptomatic. Of that 55%, 70% are mild, which is now like 38% of the people are mild, and you're left over with 38 and 55, about less than 20% of people. Of those 20%, about 40% are moderate, which means about 8%, and about 12% would present as severe. So about 12% of the population ends up in the severe category. So I don't have a lot of confidence in these numbers, but they're interesting, especially the fraction symptomatic, asymptomatic. It's just, it is a very big number. And it's still a little bit unknown what it really is.
I was just curious because last night the guy from the CDC and the NIH, he was saying that our guess is that 80% of the symptomatic cases are mild, 15% are severe, and 5% critical. They break them into even, you know, their finer categories. They don't have a moderate.
Well, moderate probably would. Okay, yeah, I see what you're saying. So these two groups together is the trouble. These could also be just considered mild because there's a range of mild from not noticing it to noticing it but not really being bothered by it that much. So those are consistent, actually.
Yes, which is interesting. The models calibrated to some values that are in the ballpark.
Yeah.
The question, do you know if any U.S. governmental authority is using your model?
No. I think I've had a little bit of influence in terms of some of the methodological things that are being used in this, but no one directly is making use of this work.
So I was seeing the CDC in the state, they have a kind of a planning a guideline for scenarios, and they are using five scenarios where they have a range for the asymptomatics that is between 20 to 50% of asymptomatic cases.
Yes. Yeah, I think the range should probably be a bit broader, but I mean, we're coming in at 46, so it's somewhere in there. It's a big number, I think.
Yeah.
But one of the things that's really hard to do is the asymptomatic contagious stage. This process of picking up the infection and then having it multiply to the point where you're shedding virus is not well understood with COVID. And the length of time that this happens and the number of people are very convolved with one another. So you could actually, this could actually be much smaller and this much longer, or this much shorter and this much bigger, and you get roughly the same results.
Because in the same document they said that 40% of the transmission is occurring in prior to symptom onset.
Yes,
and that's part of the behavior they are giving their document for scenario planning.
Yes, and that's partly because of behavioral changes on symptom onset, and partly because of the viral shed profile. And there is a little bit of information on viral shed profiles, but it's a little bit limited at this point.
Anyone has another question?
So yes. Ricardo just asked, do we have is there any evidence of immunity? Definitely not at this point. I mean, we're coming in at 12 to 15% people who've been exposed to the virus in the state of New York. So within the United States, no, there's nothing like herd immunity happening here. Within enclaves within Brazil, my guess is yes, there are places where 70% of the population has been exposed. There may very well be herd immunity effectively there, but those are separated places. There may even be communities in the U.S. where that is true, but not in the U.S. in any broad stretch. And then, I mean, India, there's just so many different places with so many different kind of ways of interacting, ability to do social distancing, and density of population that I'm sure some of them will develop herd immunity as a small cluster. And then the question is, are we going to see that in a broader population? And at this point, my guess is no, but that's my guess. I don't really know.
The other part of the question was, do you think we can have a second wave?
Absolutely, we can have a second wave. I kind of think we're gonna, in the United States at least.
In my understanding, maybe I would like to hear from you. It's not going to be only a second wave, it's going to be several waves.
So it's pretty interesting. I was actually trying to put together a seasonal flu model combined with the COVID model. And one of the things that happens is the seasonal flu, which is really the seasonality of the flu is entrained by a relatively small behavioral slash immune response changes. They don't, changes by 10 or 15% are actually more than enough to entrain a seasonal character to the flu. Those 10 or 15% are tiny, tiny numbers compared to the way that we have changed contacts as a result of COVID-19. So there could be many waves, but I think a lot of that is analogy thinking as opposed to a real understanding of the way the coronavirus is interacting with the human immune system overall. And I don't think the COVID is much like the flu, to be honest. I think these are different animals, different viruses. I think they're different viruses that are going to respond very differently in terms of population health. I may be wrong, and people who do say that have spent their lives doing epidemiological work. I have kind of only done it on the sidelines, so in some sense, I should yield to them, but the nature of this infection process is very different from that of the flu, and the R-naught of this thing is way higher than it is for the flu. And so the kind of social distancing we need to bring this under control, I think, is going to basically dampen the flu for a long time until it comes back with a vengeance when it finally does.
With a vengeance, because it'll mutate enough?
Well, so what happens with the flu is you get viral, you get immunological loss and viral drift to different things for which people are not immune. And the longer you go without having a kind of spread flu, the more likely it is that you're going to see a more serious epidemic as a result. Now, vaccines are available for the flu. Even in the U.S., though, the fraction of the population that's vaccinated is not, it's not the majority. It's relatively big. In many countries, it's almost zero.
I don't know if Ricardo meant to ask this partially, but I think part of his question might have also been asking about whether immunity will be retained if you.
I would love to know that, as would a lot of people, to understand what the immune profile is against COVID-19. I don't know the answer. I have no idea.
Any other question? The people who are participating also, Hamilton, I don't know, Paulo, Ricardo, even Juan. Any other question? So we are getting almost to our hour in our webinar. There's a second. Ricardo is making a question. Do you think we can have a sec? It's the same of the second wave. I just, I think that's what we have, Paolo. Do you know if any US? Okay, no. Yes, we don't have any
additional. Rudolf.
Yes.
Rudolf. Hi, it's Paolo. Bob, have you tried to calibrate your model? Because here, I've downloaded your model, make some adjustment, and I compare the curves in terms of the deaths and the infected people. And here in Brazil, I've noticed that the curve, when I try to adjust the curves by the infected people, the model curve for the death is dislocated for the right. Do you understand me?
Yeah, so there is often a transition problem. So let me just very briefly show you the calibration parameters that I'm using on this model.
Because here I'm doing the calibration based in the depth data.
Yes, so, well, you need to do both infections and deaths or you'll never get them both. But I'm using infectivity, crude death rate, fractured asymptomatic, the initial kind of onset date to get that, fractious symptomatic mild, quarantine effective testing failure rate. I'm actually not, I did do some calibration over the time spent in each of these different phases, although it ended up being that my initial guesses were not very far off, so I went back to using what they were. But if you've got a fairly big difference between the timing of the disease timing and the death timing, is that what you're seeing? So I've got here, like, this is presumed new infections and deaths. And I'm not having nearly enough people die, which is a little weird, but I haven't looked at this in a while.
Some would say that's a good thing, Bob.
Yes, some would say that's a good thing, but unfortunately, those people really died. So you have to do that and look at it. If you're really seeing a displacement, my guess is actually it's a measurement. It's the source of measurement. Deaths are a much more reliable, typically, measure of what's going on because they're more likely to be death certificates. Although in the case of COVID, that's not so true because a lot of them are not indicating the real cause of death. Whereas infections are really hit and miss, whether you're using testing or presumed infections, whatever you've got, it's really hard to figure out where those numbers are coming from. So that's one of the places you can get a lot of displacement.
Yeah, Paulo, you may not know this, but people are going back and doing studies, so-called excess death studies, because the death certificates are not necessarily having the right cause of death on them. And that's excess over the average would be for that time.
It's true, because we have a huge problem in terms of sub-notifications. Our data is not true. We can be sure that they are notifying the death in the right manner.
Right. Yeah, so excess deaths is really an interesting study area, but obviously it includes both people who died of COVID-19, who died as a consequence of the health system not being able to deal properly with COVID-19. So,
yes.
Okay, thank you.
Well, if no one has an additional question, I think we have reached our goal in here. Bob, would you like to make a final comment?
Thank you all for attending. This has been fun. I don't know, I guess fun is the right word, but it's been informative. This COVID-19 modeling is engaging and it's helpful because people are really interested in it. So the more we can kind of increase people's ability to think about these things systemically, I think the better off we are. So thank you for inviting me.
Okay, no. Thank you for sharing your model, sharing your time with us. We are very grateful of this moment with you. I don't know, Karim, you want to make another comment or anyone else? But for me, I would end it in here. Karim?
Okay, Bob, just to give you a feedback, you know, I've asked if your model was used in a US authority. I'm saying this because your model is being used in the Ministry of Defense in Brazil, you know, because I have a friend of mine took my model because it's based in your model, and he presented at the Ministry of Defense here in Brazil. Okay, just people and made a lot of they congratulate for the model. Okay, just a feedback.
All right,
okay.
Thank you. Thank you. It's good to know.
Okay, so thank you very much.
All right, take care, everyone.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you very much.